Amen. Amen. Open your Bibles to the book of Job. Job, J-O-B. J-O-B. Job. Gonna go to chapter 1, verse 12. Go to the book of Job, J-O-B. T, turn on the red camera, son. You got it? Okay. Job, chapter 1. Verse 12. When you guys say amen. Ain't got no amens yet. Oh, sorry, I'm patient. All right, we got a couple of them. Amen. Jada, where you at? Where you at, Jada? We don't see you today. God bless you, sister. Job, chapter 1, go down to verse 12. All right, they did the amens already. That means it's my time. All right. Sorry, I got to do all bishop job. All right, Job, chapter 1, verse 12. It says, and the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put forth not thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. One day, Satan and God had a meeting. And at the meeting, they brought up the name of Job. Amen. The Bible says, Jesus was talking to Peter. He said, Peter, Peter, hold up. He says, Satan has asked for you by name. Sometimes you don't realize that the devil asks for you by name. Some of you are going through hell right now because the devil has asked for you by name. Let's keep reading. This is the book of Job. Go to verse 13. And it says, and there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine at their elder's brother's house. And they came a messenger unto Job and said, the oxen were plowing, the asses were feeding beside them, and the Sabians, and the rolling sixties, and the eight trays, and the hoovers, and the pyrus, and the grape streets came, and they did a drive-by shooting, and they killed all of your children. I want you to think about this. Job was at his house. Chilling, it's Sunday, watching the game. He already went to church. He at home watching the game. And he got a phone call. And he says, brother, brother, your children were at home. And there was a drive-by. And some of your children got killed. Let's keep reading. Verse 14. And the Sabians fell upon them and took them away. Yes, they have slain your servants by the edge of the sword. Verse 16. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the fire of God is fallen from heaven and had burnt up all your sheep and your servants and consumed them. And I only escaped to tell thee. Back in that day, when they said burn your sheep, that was your money. So he was sitting at home and all of a sudden he got a message on his email. And it says, your bank account is zero. A scammer has gotten to your account, has stolen all your money. So not only was there a shooting and his kids got murdered, but now all his money is gone. Let's keep reading. Go down to Job, verse 17, 1 and 17. While he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the Chaldeans have made thee hands and fell upon the camels, and they have carried them away. And yes, they have slain thy servants. Yes, they have carried your camels away. So now all his cars are gone. The transportation that he had. He said, man, they done broke into your house and then took all your cars away. So his kids got murdered. Then they took all his money. And now his transportation is gone. Amen. Let's keep reading. Verse 18. And as he was yet speaking, another servant arrived and says, the sons and daughters were feeding at their elder's brother's home. And then suddenly a mighty wind came from the desert and it engulfed the house so that the roof fell in and all them that were inside are dead. And I alone escaped to tell you. Then Job stood up. He grabbed his robe. He tore it with grief and he fell down on the ground before God. But he said this, I came naked out of thy mother's house, and naked shall I return. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Sometimes you're going to have crazy days when crazy things happen. and it don't make no sense. And with Job, we're right here. Everything kept happening. One thing after the next thing, after the next thing, after the next thing. Job, this was all on the same day. The man was chilling in his house, relaxed, kicking back, watching the game. And he kept getting one bad thing after the next bad thing, after the next bad thing, after the next bad thing. We call that a season of fire. A season of fire. Have any of you ever had a season of fire where just one thing after the next thing, after the next thing keep happening? And here's the thing about season of fire. Whenever fire touches anything, it changes it. Whenever you're touched by fire, whatever is touched by fire will never be the same. It always changes. Next, go to Isaiah 43 and 2. Thank you, Jesus. Isaiah 43 and 2. Isaiah 43 and 2. Thank you, Jesus. Isaiah 43 and 2 says this. God says, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. When thou passest through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. Verse 3. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, and thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, and Ethiopia for thee. And since thou wast precious in my sight, thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee. Therefore I will give men for thee, and a people for thy life. God says, when you are walking through the fire, when you're walking in the deep side of the swimming pool, when you're walking through the storm, when you're walking through life by yourself, when you're walking into the bank and you ain't got no credit, when you're walking to the grocery store and your bank account's on negative, when you're walking through the hospital and you're sick with cancer, God says, I will be thy life. I will walk with you through the fire. Sometimes when you're going through, you got to ask God, can you walk with me? And God says, I ain't never left your side. And sometimes you say, I don't feel God. I don't see God. Where is this God? And he's like, I'm right there in the midst of it with you. It was a story about Meshach, Abednego, and Daniel. They were one time in the fiery furnace. And in this furnace, they literally is a big old room, and it had fire, and they put them in there to kill them. And while they were in the room, they were dancing around in the fire. They were dancing around in the fire. But what would happen was, one of the kings looked inside. He says, we put three men in here. But the king says, I see four. And the fourth man was Jesus. See, the thing is, you be going through stuff, and you don't realize that God is going through it with you. He's walking with you through the storm. And the reason how you know God is with you is because you're still here. If God wasn't with you, you wouldn't still be here. He would have took you out. He would allow the devil to take you out a long time ago. But the fact that you're still alive means that God is in your life, even if you can't see him. Because God says, I touched you and I woke you up this morning. I kept you when you should have been dead. You should have been shot. You should have been raped. You should have been killed. But I kept you to make sure that you're still here to walk through the journey. God is walking with you, even though you can't see him. He will not let you die in the fiery furnace. Go to Isaiah 48 and 10. Isaiah 48 and 10. Isaiah 48 and 10. And this is why some of you are in the fire. This is why some of your mama's acting a fool. This is why my wife went out the other door. This is why some of the things is going on in your life. Isaiah 48 and 10. It says, behold, I have refined thee, but not as silver. I have chosen thee in the furnace of affliction. Let me say it again. Behold, I have refined thee, but not with silver. I have chosen thee in the furnace of affliction. God says, you going through hell right now. And what he means is, he said this. I didn't put a big gold chain on your neck. My grandbaby got a nice polo shirt on. And God said, I didn't put no polo on you. I didn't put you in a brand new Mercedes. He says, you going through this hell on a bus stop. You going through this hell sleeping homeless downtown LA. You going through this hell in a hospital. You going through this hell while somebody's choking the life out of you. You going through this hell while bullets is flying over your head. But he says, I have chosen you in your mess. I have chosen you in your pain. I have chosen you in your sadness. I have chosen you in your depression. I have chosen you in your loneliness. I have chosen you in your sickness. I have chosen you in the things that you're going through. Some of the things that you're going through is because just like Job, God chose him. God has chosen you. And because you've chosen, you got to go through something. See, you got to go through something because you got to have a story to tell. You can't be successful without a story. What good is a 50-year marriage if there's no trouble? What good is a college degree if you'd have to struggle like hell to get it? What good is a good job if you don't have a story to tell behind it? God says, I've chosen you in your affliction. Some of you are going through the very hell that you're going through right now because God says, I chose you, man. I chose you, young lady. And because I chose you, the devil has a target on your back. See, Satan always saw Job. But he knew that as long as God had covered him, he couldn't protect, he couldn't touch him. But God says, I'm going to take the protection off of him. And he says, he'll never turn to you. Some of you need to be the steadfast like Job. You need to have be rooted in the ground, saying, for God I live, for God I die. Never leave God's side. Because if God be for you, after the test is over, you're going to get double for your trouble. After you go through the hell that you went through, God says, I've been having these Mercedes keys for the last 10 years. God says, I got this college degree, I got this house, I got this vacation, but you got to go through something. Some of you are in the fire. Stay in the fire and understand why you're there. Yeah, it's hot. Yeah, it's hell, but know that God has something on you for the other side of this thing. So hang in there, child of God. Don't you quit while in the fire. Graduation day is coming. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Your graduation day is coming. Turn me to book of Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 13. Thank you, Jesus. Zechariah chapter 13. Zechariah chapter 13. Go down to verse 8. When you guys say amen, that means I ain't got it. Zechariah chapter 13. All right, I'm coming. It's coming. It's coming. I was going through this morning, so I didn't get a chance to write the sermon there. I was crying when they closed my movie theater. I was depressed. I couldn't believe it. I said, what is going? The devil's alive. All right. Zechariah chapter 13. Go down to verse 8. There it is. Sorry, I'm getting here. Go. It says, and it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left therein. Verse 9. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and I will refine them as silver is refined, and I will try them as gold is tried, and they shall call upon my name, and I will hear them. I will say, you are my people, and they shall, the Lord is my God. God said, there's a people. Two-thirds have fallen off. Look around this church. Most people don't go to church. Most people do it Sunday, fun day. I'm at the game. I'm kicking it. I'm at the beach. I'm getting it in. I'm getting high. I'm at a day party. We doing everything. It's Sunday, fun day. The Bible says two-thirds shall fall away. Here's the secret about life. And it's sad because I do a whole lot of funerals. Most people ain't going nowhere near God's heaven. And so I'm sorry. Look around the churches. It ain't hard to tell. How can you say that? Because in the book of Revelation 11 and 7, God says they worship God day and night. The people that go to heaven, all they do is go to church. I don't know why we think we're going to heaven and we're going to the strip club. I don't think why we're going to heaven and we're going to go gamble. When you go to heaven, you're going to church. Why would God take somebody to heaven who don't want to go to church when they had a choice? See, life is about choice. And we think God will be mocked, that God's going to be like, well, I knew that watching the NFL was more important than me. That's a lie in the pit of hell. God said, put him first and he'll put you first. So the thing is, these people need to understand that. All right, Zechariah. So God says that you're being refined through the fire. You're being tried through the fire. And it's because God has chosen you. Turn to Job 23 and 10. Thank you, Jesus. Job 23 and 10. Job 23 and 10. Job 23 and 10. Job 23 and 10. Job 23 and 10 says this. But he know the way that I take. And when he had tried me, I shall come forth as pure gold. Job never turned away from God. He said, God knows where I'm in. He knows what I'm feeling. He knows what I'm going through. But he says, I will never turn away from God. Because said, when he's finished with me, I shall come forth as pure gold. You want to be on the golden side of life, where God has seen you through the fire, but now he has some gold for you on the other side of that thing. If you keep hanging in there and living, you will understand the golden side of life and the life of eternity with God. Turn to 2 Corinthians 4 and 17. That's right, grandbaby. 2 Corinthians 4 and 17. 2 Corinthians 4 and 17. I'm going to read verses 17 through 18. This is me. God says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, but it worketh for us a far exceeding and eternal weight of glory. God says, what you're going through is light. What? I lost my mama. What you're going through is light. I lost my job. God says, what you're going through is lightweight. I got shot. God says, what you're going through is lightweight. I was in a car accident. God says, what you're going through is lightweight. But he says, you will get glory from that thing. God says, you're going to get a whole lot of good things from the hell that you're going through now. Why would God put me through something? God, I'm tired of these tests. See, God can't take you to the next level until you pass the test. That's right, grandbaby. That's why they call it a testimony. That's why they call it a testimony. A testimony can only be told if you pass the test. See, if you never went through nothing, you can't do nothing. How many of y'all got a car? Raise your hand. You got a car. A good car, like a Toyota or a Honda or a Mazda, is a car that can survive the test. See, if you trust your car, you can test your car and you know your car won't let you down. Imagine if your car broke down everywhere you went. Imagine every morning you got to start it up and it would never start. That's not a good car. But if your car starts up when you need to start up, if you push the gas and it goes, if you hit the brakes and it stops, that's a good car. And God says, the only way this car became good, somebody tested it. God is testing you. God is testing me. I was crying all morning long. And my good friend Lachelle said, well, baby, you're crying because of this. She said, you've been going through hell. 2022 has been hell for you. Everything in your life has changed. Compton High School is on the ground. My job title has changed. My household has changed. My marriage status has changed. My finances has changed. Everything around me has changed. So when that little movie theater closed, I was like, God, what's going on? Everything around me is gone. And God said, man, I'm testing you, Michael. Some of you are being tested right now. And when you're being tested, you got to learn how to stand there and do your test. But God says, did you study? Matter of fact, turn to Psalms 119, 105. God says, did you study? Psalms 119, 105. Amen. Psalms 119, 105. Psalms 119, 105 says this. Thank you, Jesus. It says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto thy path. God says, if you study his word, he will give you his word which will light your pathway. See, this morning, while I was going through the emotions and all this stuff, I had to grow out and reach to the Bible, reach into God's word. And God said, man, you know this thing gonna be all right. He says, you know this thing is temporary. But imagine this, everything that you're going through is temporary. Everything that you're going through right now is temporary. Nothing lasts forever. And what my friend got me to realize, she said, Michael, you've been trusting on a little movie theater to give you peace. She says, the only way you have peace is by trusting in God. And I learned a whole lesson this morning. Because Hebrews 13 and 8 says, God never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. God says, stop trusting in men. Stop trusting in money. Stop trusting in children. Stop trusting in relationships. Stop trusting in cars. Stop trusting in things that you can see. And trust in God. Because when you trust in God, God never changes. We trust in people. Every person you trust in will disappoint you. The Bible says in Jeremiah 17 and 5, cursed be the man that trusteth in another man. If you trust in a job, it will let you down. It will fire you. It will lay you off. Trust in God, because God never changes. See, God is like that steady runner. Everywhere you go, you see him. And if you keep following him, he'll lead you along the way that you should go. Trust in God, and your life will never change. And next, turn with me to Luke 17. We're almost done. Luke 17. Thank you, Jesus. 17. Luke 17 said this. And Jesus answered. We're going to talk about this more on Tuesday. And Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 lepers that were cleansed? But I only see but one. Verse 18, they are not found that return to give glory to the God, save this stranger. And he said unto him, arise and go thy way. Thy faith has made thee whole. And Jesus says, were there not 10 lepers that were cleansed? But there are the 9. But where are the 9? Verse 18, they are not found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. Verse 19, and he said unto him, arise and go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole. What does that mean? Jesus had healed 10 people who had leprosy. If you don't know what leprosy is, imagine monkeypox. It's a disease that made your skin white. And the disease was sort of like, we had this little COVID thing to go on. No, leprosy was real. So the thing is, if one person was a leper in this room, we all get infected. So if you had leprosy, you couldn't come into any family dwelling. Matter of fact, you couldn't even come into the city. They were sort of like the homeless people 2,000-3,000 years ago. They had to live outside in a little homeless encampment. They couldn't come nowhere near people. So if you got leprosy, even if you had a family, they'd put you out the house and they would throw you out. You couldn't come nowhere near them. So Jesus was walking one day and he saw these 10 lepers. And he prayed for them, and they got healed. And the thing was, when the 9 got healed, they walked away. But one of them came back. And he came back, and he fell down, he started crying. They said, thank you so much. And Jesus says, where are the other 9? He says, I don't know. And he says, thy faith has made thee whole. What does that mean? Whatever you're going through, be thankful. What? Whatever you're going through, be thankful. Whatever you're going through, know that God sees your pain. You know that God sees your pain? Do you know that God hears your cries? Do you know God reads your mind? He sees you going through that thing. But if you can go through that thing and still have a good attitude, God says your faith will make you whole. You want God to make you whole. You want your whole life to be whole. You want your finances to be whole. You want your health to be whole. You want your relationship to be whole. You want God to make me whole. And what is whole? Whole means this. I'm going to be all right. Whether it's good, I'm going to be all right. When it's bad, I'm going to be all right. When I'm sad, I'm going to be all right. When I'm lonely, I'm going to be all right. If you are whole, God can make you all right. That means you have the peace of God running through your veins. Matter of fact, turn to John 14:27. Thank you, Jesus. John 14:27. John 14:27 says this: peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. God says, I'm giving you peace today. He says, take this peace and deal with your problem. Take this peace and deal with that trouble. Take this peace and deal with whatever you're going through. Because if you have God's peace, you're going to be all right. And I thank God for his peace. Because it's by his peace that I woke up this morning. It's by his peace that I had somewhere to sleep last night. It's by his peace that I'm safe and sound. It's by his peace that I'm standing here today. I thank God for his peace. Because his peace says, Michael, you're going to be all right. God wants you to know today, whatever you're going through, you're going to be all right. And if you can understand that, you won't feel a certain way anymore. Because God says, you're going to be all right. You're going to be all right. Because God foresaw your season of pain. And the very last thing, turn to Psalms 25:4. We're done after this. Psalms 25:4. Thank you, Jesus. Psalms 25:4. Psalms 25:4. When you got to say amen. Psalms 25:4. Psalms 25:4 says this. Remember, show me thy ways, O Lord. Teach me thy path. Lead me in thy truth and teach me, for thou art the God of my salvation, and on thee do I want all day long. Show me thy ways, O Lord, and teach me thy paths. When God created you, he created you with a purpose. What happens in life is we get lost. We get lost in our desires. We get lost in Netflix and Hulu and Instagram and FaceTime and all these different things. Some of us get lost in video games. Some of us get lost on Pornhub. We get lost at the weed shop. We get lost wherever we get. Some of us get lost. This right here says, God, show me thy ways and show me thy path. Show me the way. God, I'm lost. Can you show me the way? How many of you ever been lost before? I know I have. I've been lost physically and spiritually. Everything that I tried didn't work. I was lost. When I tried to go to college, got kicked out. I was lost. I tried to buy this thing. Didn't work out. I was lost. Sometimes when great things happen, you're so disappointed that you end up lost. Because you trusted that this thing would work and that it would last. And God says, that wasn't for you. Sometimes God will shake the dust. That means he will shake people out of your life. He will shake situations out of your life. Because he says, that's taking you in the wrong direction. God has a path for you. So your prayer, God, show me my path. God, show me my life. God, show me where you want me to go. Because if you walk the path that God has for you, everything around you will start to grow, and you will start to prosper and do all that he's called you to do. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Everybody stand. Amen. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Amen. Hey, sir, amen. Right on time, Doc. It's a blessing. Amen. Life has no guarantees. Life has no guarantees. That's hard. Because sometimes we put our parents and say, they'll always be there. No guarantee. My job will always be there. Compton High has been there since 1896. It's gone. Life has no guarantees. And what we like to do, we like to trust. Well, I'm trusting in this. And God says, Satan can take it away. So what we have to do is learn how to trust in the God that we've never seen. How do you do that? Your faith increases first by hearing God's word. That's number one. That's why we come to church, hear God's word. Some of you need to listen to more gospel music. I know NBA Youngboy is great, and Kodak Black is cool, and all these different things. That's fine, but that ain't gonna get you through nothing when the devil's on your tail. When I had to see a lady, I had to do a funeral this past week, and this young lady had to bury her son. Kodak Black ain't gonna get you through that. Michael Jackson ain't gonna get you through that. You gonna need some word from God. Someone had to get into your soul and spin it around like a washing machine. You gonna need God's word to get you through those tough times that don't make sense. And ask God to keep your mind. When you look at these the people that walk in the street, the homeless folk and all these different things, a lot of those people were just like you. Normal. They were normal. Good life. A matter of fact, 99% of people were not born homeless. The homeless that we have here in Los Angeles today, they were regular people. Most of them went to school. Some of them, 25% of the homeless population has college degrees. There was a homeless couple downtown LA. One of them went to Yale, the other went to Harvard. And they were black, homeless, downtown LA. How did they get that way? Because something happened in their life that they trusted in, and God took it away, Satan took it away, and they lost their natural mind. They couldn't focus anymore. I remember meeting this one lady, she had to bury her son. Lost it, turned to an alcoholic, been on the streets ever since. So the thing is, God says, stop trusting in things that are temporary. Stop trusting in things that are temporary, and trust in me. Because when you trust God, even though the devil took things away, you're going to say, you know what? I'm going to cry. Like I cried this morning. I was crying for hours. You would think of somebody died. I cried. But God said, it's going to be all right. Because you still have me. I'm still here. And the Bible says, if he's for us, you know the rest of that. Nothing will prevail against you. If God is at your source, if God is your right-hand man, if God is all that to you, then you're going to be all right. Even when you got to have some sad days, God says, trust me. Stop trusting things. And the beautiful thing, although Job lost much, God gave him double. Some of y'all need to say, God, I had to do this terrible thing. I did it, Lord, and I still trust you. Can I have double? You have the ability to ask for double for God for the troubles that you went through. Some of y'all went through crazy things. God, give me double. I want double in my relationship, double in my finances, double in my children, double in my blessings. And God says, you got it because you never lost the faith. God wants you to be blessed. Your testimony will save somebody's life. Some of the things that Sir went through. Sir had a crazy life. If you ever told your story, they would not believe. This man, it was in a real shootout. Like video game. Bing, bing. Bing, bing. Bullets flying all over the place. But he's still here. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. God is amazing. And that's how I got saved. Amen. Anybody have any words? Oh, and before we leave, grandbaby got straight A's. Give her a hand clap. Hallelujah. Yeah, she got 7 A's. Amen. I ain't never got all A's in my whole life. The devil's a lie. All right, everybody grab a hand. Everybody grab a hand. Bow your head. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today, Father. We thank you for life after pain, life after enduring hell, life after enduring disappointment. Thank you, God, for the new life, for the new opportunities, for the new blessings. Squeeze the hand next to you. I squeeze life into that hand. I squeeze prosperity into that hand. And I squeeze the peace of God into that hand. That these young people come to head and not to tail. That they become victorious and never defeated. And that no weapon, no disappointment, no sadness, no thing taken away will take them out of your hand, Father. But we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Hug somebody. Mika, come here. I want to wear it, huh? Hey, boy, right on time, Scott. That's all right. No, you good. Oh. Y'all will fight over that car. Y'all work it out. All right.